the user is the same. Please understand. You know, when you look at it, which channels you watch, which sites you read, and you will get the answer yourself. I think fundamentally the user is the same user. It is at what point of time what you're consuming is driven by a personal habit and not really by language. Okay. Typically, otherwise the GCs would largely be English, right? GCs are not in English.
But entertainment is easily the most seen, and if a big thing is happening with, say, cricket match is happening, which your team does better than others, the traffic goes up. Or anything to do with where it's a lot of sense of pride for an Indian, you know, if you launch a satellite which is among the three in the world, you know, then everybody wants to read that, you know.
Okay, and where's the traffic coming from?
Sorry, we'll have to take this offline.
We'll have to, you know, we can
thanks,
take this.
Thank you very much. Thank you to all our panelists. As you said, we have the report release on proliferation of Indian languages on the internet. I request our panelists and our moderator to please release this. If you'd like a copy for yourself, this is available in the stall upstairs in the exhibition area. Kindly get a copy from there.
Excuse me.
Thank you. We also have a token of appreciation for all our panelists and our moderator. Thank you very much, gentlemen. A quick announcement about lunch. Every delegates with the gold and platinum pass, you all can have lunch here in this hall at the back. Everyone else with the silver and silver plus passes, you all have to have lunch. The lunch will be served in the lunch area, which is next to the exhibition area upstairs. Right, we'll start the next session in an hour from now. Thank you very much. The next session, India Digital Summit. We begin with our post-lunch session, the panel discussion on financial inclusion, advancing financial inclusion in India. I would like to invite our speakers to kindly come up and take their seats. Mr. V. George Anthony, Managing Director of UAE Exchange. Mr. Pradeep Sampath, Chief Operating Officer, MMP Mobi Wallet Payment. Mr. Paresh Razde, Founder, Suvidha InfoServe. Mr. Bhavin Modi, Director, E-Billing Solutions. And Mr. Pawan Bakshi, Senior Program Officer, Financial Services at the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, will be joining us shortly. And to moderate this session, I would like to invite Dr. Laveesh Bhandari, Director, Indicus Analytics. The session will be for 1 hour, including question answers. Thank you.
That a large part of our discussion would be centered around those. However, I'd like to just start off this discussion with a couple of points about financial inclusion. Till today, the most successful financial inclusion model is that of the local money lender. It hasn't really, the government has tried a lot, many different models have worked in many different countries, but nothing has been as prevalent, as sustained, as popular as the money lender. And of course, the money lending financial inclusion model is not entirely the objective for a country like India. The government has tried many things in the past. Many of us might recall that there was the bank nationalization, which was aimed at financial inclusion, so that you could have greater rural branches and so on. That didn't really work very well. Then many other things were tried, and payments banks, financial inclusion, digital inclusion are all the new, I'd like to call it the new technology inclusion, which seems to be the fashion now. Will it succeed? In all likelihood, it should, at least most of us like to believe that it will. There are obviously many challenges. Most importantly, there are many, many technology challenges, coverage challenges, challenges related to HR, challenges related to liquidity or cash management, which still need to be figured out. We are in very, very early days. And what we have out here is a panel which brings many different angles into that whole financial inclusion story. So I will not go into introducing each of the panelists, but I would ask to do a one round of introductions so that all of us can also get a better idea of your take and where it comes from. So I'll start off the first thing. The rules of the game are simple. Each round, we speak for about between 2 to 4 minutes. If someone has a query or something, please do raise your hand. I will not stop the person from speaking at that point in time. I may or may not ask you to put in your comment. But towards the end of this, of a couple of 2 or 3 rounds, then we'll have a back and forth. Thank you.
Hi, good afternoon. I'm George Anthony, Managing Director for UAE Exchange India. Okay, about financial inclusion. Okay, UAE Exchange is in the last 4 years we have got this PPI license from Reserve Bank of India. We are also a NBFC lending to the rural customers. And since we got this PPI license, we wanted to really grow this business model using wallet. And we have tried many models, and every time we have got stuck because of varied reasons. One is technology issues, one is cultural issues, one is people educating people. And when these license came, and the phones the people were using didn't have GPRS, all this are part of the reasons why wallet was not taking off. But right now things have changed a lot. And 2-3 things I wanted to share. You know, just 10 days back, I wanted to pay some money to my, one of my laborer was working in my farm. So I was traveling, so he called me. So I said, I'll credit your account. Then he jokingly said, sir, what? That and all will not work for us. I need cash. I need to pay cash to my workers because they need that money in the evening for whatever they want to do. So this, my point I wanted to convey here is this bank accounts will solve financial issues. I really don't agree. How the common man is able to do transaction digitally from his bank account is what can bring financial inclusion. So
the UAE exchange, I mean, brings with it a great in a whole range of different technologies, products, processes, which I'm sure can prove very useful. And I mean, I'd like you to pick up on this particular point that you just mentioned as we go along.
Hi, good afternoon. My name is Pradeep Sampath, and I'm the Chief Operating Officer of MMP Mobi Wallet, which runs the wallet under the brand name MRupee. It's a part of Tata Teleservices. My take on financial inclusion is that it's actually a very diverse country with about 53% of people who do not have access to a formal financial medium. It also has too many cultural and demographical issues. And more importantly, in terms of reaching out to the customer, that's where the real challenge lies, according to me, in terms of delivering the financial inclusion to the customer. And we have, just like what George talked about, you just by giving a transaction to a particular individual is not going to bring in a financial inclusion. You need to create a supporting ecosystem around it, which is where the real challenge lies. The second thing that it is important is that you are going to deliver these services through a set of retailers and distributors who are going to be delivering this service on your behalf. And hence, you're not going to get a direct connect with the customer at some point in time. And that brings in an additional complexity because you need to be represented fairly, properly in front of the customer. And he has to be assisted because this kind of a customer who is not included also needs assistance, and that's what the retailer does. So there are multiple challenges that are there in terms of delivering this service to the customer. And as we talk about KYC, our experience is that these customers typically have a prepaid phone connection, and every month they go for a different phone connection. So which means that even if you have a mobile wallet given to him on a particular month on a particular phone, it's likely to change the next month. And you know, these are the complexities that we need to address. It is not about whether the PPI or a payment bank or a small bank which is going to succeed in delivering financial institution. And in our own experience, we have actually tried joining hands with some of the MFIs and creating some ecosystem around the whole play. And at this point in time, I would say we are doing some kind of a POC, and we are seeing some traction. It's only a question of time as we move forward as to how we'll see the results. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Paresh Rajde. I'm founder of Suvidha InfoServe. We are one of the largest and the could be the oldest in that space as far as the financial inclusion is concerned. Though we started as the service, as a company, as a digital inclusion where the people cannot transact online, they go to the nearest outlet and transact, whether it's a railway ticketing or airline or bill payments or utilities, etc., etc. And then we pioneered a couple of initiatives. One is that if you go and buy the railway ticket from an agent, the whole initiative was pioneered by us, and then we tied up with the railway. We were the first to connect to the railway. Then what you see the current form of domestic remittance, again, we were the pioneer and we started about in 2011. We ran this about a year or so, and then today we still remain the number one and the largest player in that space. We do about overall 10,000 crore worth of remittance and all other transactions in India today. So we are fairly strong in that. Today the model of the working with us is we have never been gone as a PPI route. That does not fit into our philosophy. We always work with any partner bank, and today we are one of the largest partner with the Axis Bank, and where we are the, you can say, the 25,000 outlets network with the Axis Bank as provide the various banking services. So it's from the bank account to the remittance to the credit. Today we already launched 2 months back, it's called Nano Credit. Virtually the rickshaw puller or the guy which is on the ground, he comes to the outlet and he say that I want the money. We churn the data on the fly, and we have about 35 million unique consumers on our platform by now actually. So we churn the data, what kind of a remittance, transactions, etc., what he's doing it, which takes us the score of a consumer. And virtually we are giving about in 1 hour we are giving the loan. So we are disbursing the loan within 1 hour. Our target is to disburse this loan in 5 minutes in going forward, within say 2 months or so. So right now that's the way we are disrupting the technology. So we have disrupted the various things. We have disrupted even remittance space. We are now disrupting into the credit and MFI space also, where we are giving the disbursing the loan, which it's again an individual loan. So it's not a JLG or SHG and something like that. So it's a, we are pure play of, I would say that the company is more of an DNA is towards the fintech distribution and handholding, which is the assisted, and that's how we work.
Hello everyone, my name is Bhavin Modi, and I am the director at eBilling Solutions. It's also known as EBS. It's an online payment aggregation platform that we provide. So, when it comes to financial inclusion, we do not play a direct role in driving financial inclusion in the country as such. However, there are many things that we can do to, drive this with partners in the country. So, I'll take a step back over here, and, I'm a usually very, positive-minded person. So I think financial inclusion the various parts of this puzzle are, you know, coming together very well. Some of the things, you know, which are required to push financial inclusion or accelerate financial inclusion in India, the first and foremost is the government push. I think there are a number of initiatives which are being driven towards digital money, towards, you know, opening of or getting access to bank accounts, easing the KYC procedures. So I think there are enough and more initiatives which the government is driving in a country like India in order to, you know, accelerate the inclusion project. Second is, you know, very important is the infrastructure requirement. So we are now fastest growing smartphone market in the world, fastest growing internet market in the world, and this is the infrastructure which can really accelerate inclusion in a country like India. So in terms of connectivity and infrastructure, we are growing at a very, very rapid pace. The third one is, you know, the points which some of my colleagues over here spoke about, which is the ecosystem, the last mile delivery. So again, this here is where, you know, companies like ours can play a big role in providing technology solutions to the various players in this space in order to ease the last mile delivery, in order to create this ecosystem in a very efficient way. So those are some of the initiatives that we are working on, which during the course of the discussion I will, you know, talk more about. And lastly is, you know, in a country as varied as India, what is absolutely required is localization. So until, you know, we are delivering products and services in a very, very local manner, local language, these services or products will not get consumed in a country like India. So again, we have certain features and certain services oriented towards this. As the session goes along, we will talk more about it. So those were, you know, my views around how the acceleration around financial inclusion will happen in India.
Hey guys, first of all, apologies to the entire group. I walked in a bit late. I'm Pavan. I am with the Gates Foundation. I head the Financial Services for the Poor program in India. And unlike all the gentlemen here, I am just a thought partner in what it could be and what it would mean. And we believe that we are at a juncture where everything else is destructive is about to happen. And what I mean by that is that what we call is layered innovation that has made possible things which weren't either available or could be done a bit earlier. So I'll give you an example of Uber, right? Uber is today, it's possible because you've got a smartphone in your hand, you've got a payment sort of device in your hand, you've got app makers there, you've got guys who are drivers who have cabs available with spare capacity there. So that, you know, gets everything in together for you to be able to run an Uber. To run an Uber about 8-10 years ago may not have been as possible, right? So it's at that stage of development where it's all come together. And we believe in financial inclusion now in the country, there is are the ingredients there which are now possible to do. And you have a lot of infrastructure, ecosystem, changes in regulation, and support of the government, all which is possible. And the fact that we guys are sitting here and talking about it is the fact that it's about to happen if it's not already started off. And we'll talk about it as we do go along. Yeah, I won't.
Thanks, Pavan. Good to introduce a dose of optimism in this group. Anyone who's been in India and has gone through, forget about rural India, any part of urban India, knows the tremendous problem of connectivity. And that is very, very closely linked to the success of the mobile-based financial transactions. There is, now imagine what the problems we face in urban India, and they are enhanced at least tenfold, if not 100-fold, in large parts of rural India. And given the fact that you are playing on network effects, the problem gets enhanced even more. that is the one big current right now, that is the biggest challenge. Like you with your experience in technology, though of course you don't face probably the kind of problems that we do in India. So I'd like you to bring in some of your
you talk about village technology access problems. Now, from a company's point of view, whether it's UAE exchange or a small bank or a payment bank or a regular bank, everybody is talking about business and profits, right? When they invest, they will look at profits. Now, you are very clear in the next 2-3 years' time, mobile and mobile payment is going to really disrupt the current system. That's the way we look at things. Now, whenever I travel across India so extensively. So you see so much spaces where there's no banks, there's no branches. So earlier, 2 years back when we travel, okay, we are going to open a branch here. This is the thinking which first comes to any banker or any NBFC or any financial institution. Today, many are closing their branches because thinking of opening a branch is going away slowly because it is an investment, it is a huge cost where, and we are very, very clearly you can visualize in 1 year down the lane, my time frame is 1 year to 2 years. Where India will be 100% digital in the payment space. Why? Because 2-3 reasons. Government of India and the from top to bottom, from Modi to bottom, so focused on digitalization. RBI is so focused on digitalization. And all the financial institutions in India are focused on how do we go first with innovation and wallets. So that being the case, how this penetration into the rural is, they all have a mobile, they all have voice connection. It's only a matter of getting into a technology which will work. The data will get more faster than voice. It's possible. Now WhatsApp is there with everybody, and to transfer payment data, it takes 2-3 bytes only. So it's all on the way, on the go. It's just going to happen. Few regulatory changes, and you will see India moving to maybe world's number one in digital space. That's my confidence.
Great to know. Just think, but India has this ability of making the possible impossible. So anyone else who wants to comment on this, do you really believe that we'll have great connectivity in the next 1 or 2 years, be able to circumvent this problem?
Of course, Bhavan is a much more better person to answer this question, but I'll just take it up. Let's understand the perspective rather than just shouting about that, you know, the connectivity is not available and like that. We started in early 2007 or the later part of the 2007, and you can understand at that point of time the telecom network or connectivity, and mind well, I'm talking about the data connectivity even at that point of time. So there wasn't enough of the data connectivity or data usage of the data, was not even in the concepts or understanding of the even telcos also. Some of the telco we have pushed it in the year of 2003-2004 that please provide the data connectivity, and there is some business lies in the data. However, when we started the services, we have never thought of as a company, as a philosophy, that we will do it offline and online. If the data is not available, you can't transact. So I say stop it. No way that we want to do it the offline or online kind of a mixer of the architecture or design at all. We say that in the context, wherever the telecom is able to go, it is much more wider than what as a financial institute can go into those territory or terrain of those area. So I think, you know, we are just talking about that, you know, connectivity is not available. I think we have a best of the best connectivity considering the geographic reach. China may be much better to an extent, but that does not mean that, you know, we are very much lagging behind. The telecom companies are doing fabulously good job to reach out to, you know, as much as deeper as possible. And now since the data usage is there, I think it's more profound there. As a company or as an institute, I think there is enough of the space available where the data is available. So let's focus on those areas.
let the telecom go first and then you follow them. I think it's enough of the roadmap which is available for any of the companies like us. Right, Pawan? What about you?
My view is that, you know, it's actually not about connectivity and technology. Because if you actually listen to this customer, we've not reached a stage where a financial inclusion customer is doing a self-initiated transaction. We've not reached a stage where he is adept with technology, he is able to use these, you know, technologies that we are going to provide. Irrespective of whether it is 2G or 3G, and we possibly see customer who is not even able to do a transaction or even send an SMS or read an SMS, and that's essentially where the customer is. And that is the customer who we are targeting to provide an inclusion story to him, right? And so the modus operandi is not about creating a wonderful app and, you know, delivering it to him on his phone. It is about getting an assisted transaction, and that's what everybody is doing here. When you say assisted transaction, we go to that particular market and we try and, you know, get some representatives who we, in our parlance, we call a retailer and a distributor, who's going to represent you on behalf of us. And he's the guy where the customer will go, like he buys a soap, like he buys an oil, he's going to go to that shop and get these services done. And the economics actually lies in the ability of the retailer to see an opportunity to make some extra bucks. And that's the real fundamental issue that is here. And as long as you don't get to him that scale, right? If you go to a village and village has about 1,000 people and 1,000 people are going to do 1,000 transactions a month, and if you're going to say that you're going to pay 2 rupees, then the retailer is going to equate it saying 1,000 into 2, it's 2,000 bucks is what is the money that I'm going to make. And that's the real equation that we need to get to, and that's where we are struggling, because unless you have a scale, the retailer is not going to be willing to put his own money and do the transaction. And unless he comes in and becomes a party to this, you will not be able to scale it up. And that is the real crux of the challenge in my view.
Bhavin, you're in the business of billing, right? How are you building in the, though the telcos love to say that there is no technology problem, I mean, my experience is that there is. So is there anything in the kind of products that we have that can build in this problem of connectivity? I maintain that there is a connectivity.
No, so I think the connectivity problem, you have to look at the context. So if we are talking about an assisted commerce kind of a scenario, I agree with, I mean, the stalwarts are here. We have to agree to them that there is no connectivity issue. So they do it on the field every day. So I really wouldn't want to challenge them. So in case of an assisted e-commerce, or assisted commerce rather, I don't think a connectivity challenge would be there. But when it comes to, you know, a person doing it on its own, and see, again, assisted e-commerce in my mind, again rings the bell that it's still a cash transaction. Of course, the transaction is getting fulfilled electronically end to end, but the person who is the consumer of this service or consumer of this product is actually going to the outlet and paying in cash. Of course, there is an account getting opened in the back end, but I don't know how many of them are becoming aware that there is an account getting opened in the back end and the money is going from there. So it still is, in my mind, it is still having that cash angle to it. So in order to have a real cashless economy, I think that is where, to your point, there is a connectivity issue. There is more than connectivity, there is an infrastructure issue in terms of smartphone penetration and things like that, localization of services. So those are the things as and when, I think most companies are already progressing in that direction. We have so many multilingual phones, we have smartphones coming for less than 1,000 rupees. So I think all those things are now falling together, and eventually I think we will come with an unassisted commerce as well. I mean, that's my take on this.
Well, I think, it's a couple of issues here. I think the first issue is that it seems to me that it's almost impossible to sort of cover 3.29 million square kilometers of the country, right? It's as large as that. And come and think of it, that the antennas which beam, to don't have intelligence. So they beam on both sides of the border. So you will have an issue where you'll say that don't put antennas on the border, which is what's the work the government is saying today. I mean, has been saying because of security issues. You can't enter into Naxalite areas due to security concerns. So there will be places where you will not have connectivity. But having gone and said that, we don't even know where there is connectivity, right? Because if you look at the telcos, they say so many square kilometers is covered. So much of a population is covered. But they don't ever tell you, like you do that, you have electricity in a number of villages, right? So is that available data available? No. I don't know because I've not ever gone and seen it. So is that the way to start reporting it first? So the first question I think is about reporting, saying, are we reporting the right things? And hence from that, are we then alluding to the right kind of facts that if there is no coverage in an area where there is a population of 100 people lying there, will a telco want to go there and invest in infrastructure? That's the other question which we'll cover out. So there are issues around connectivity which have both sides of the coin, unfortunately. So I think the first beat is to get the reporting right, that you actually know. And from what I hear from my discussions with the other people, there were about 1,600 odd points which are termed as critical, which needed to have connectivity. And in the last about a year or so, about 900 such points have been already covered. So about 600 or 700 such points where you do need connectivity is not covered yet. So I think it's work in progress, and I think it'll happen. But the key question which I'm more worried about is not about connectivity, it's about the assisted mode. So in the assisted mode, you cannot call the guy financially included. So while we start on with that, there has to be because we know for sure, as examples have gone shown in Pakistan and Bangladesh and elsewhere, assisted mode has not allowed those guys to go up and grow. Pakistan as an example is a country full of enigma, that they have the agents in place, they have the what they call is NADRA, which is equivalent of UID in place. All those customers are identified, they all have the harmonization of KYC is being done, all of that stuff is happening. But transactions are not increasing just because it remains assisted. So how do you move from an assisted mode to a self-transacting mode is the key question to crack. And it could happen by the fact that what is that one or two transactions which we think are the hooks for this guy to utilize it? And what I believe is that the issue is cash itself, right? Cash is problematic, right? Cash, both for the economy, since it's very, very expensive to print and logistics and everything else and maintain it, and some rough estimates say that the cost of logistics alone of cash is 1% of the cash in circulation. Having gone and said that, how much can you save in cash? Right, you can save $1,000 or $2,000 or $5,000 or $10,000 in cash. Where will you store it? So you can't actually store cash. So cash itself is a problem. And the biggest problem, if you go back and study this, and if you ask Pradeep and Ms. Rajde, is that where is the problem? So if you were to receive your salary in cash, what are the chances that you will go and stand in a queue to put it back in an account? Very slim chances. It's an activity full of friction, and 90% people are in cash. So if we have to move this, if we have to move the needle on this, can we really get some both policy and regulation in place to say pay people in their accounts? Right. So can we pay? I mean, we talk of inclusion, but if I could pay my driver in an account, I would. He has no account. I've asked him to open one and he still doesn't want to. My maid, if they had the cash in their account, there's a very strong likelihood he would transact himself. Right?
So that's one way to go.
But imagine a world where the government is not going to mandate those kind of things. So essentially, then the whole growth will need to be organic. And organic growth essentially requires phenomenal delivery, and the point that you mentioned. And I think Paresh, you would have had a lot of experience in this, of how are you engaging with the customers, and the great skill and effort and costs of engaging with the customers, right? That may end up being one of the critical elements. Please throw light on that.
So, you know, I agree with the panel, and, you know, there is a one very clear-cut view is coming it up, is that, you know, somewhere you have to move the people into the self-service, basically. However, we need to understand that, you know, the people in India today, whatever said and done, I don't think the education level is so low in India, but still about only 8% of the population transact online. Only 8% of the population. That does not mean that, you know, the India is so illiterate in that way, right? So even if the people are literate, still are not able to transact online for various reasons. So now let's not get into that one. But when you're talking about the financially excluded people, right, I think it is too much of an ask for the people right now, at least sitting at this moment, that, you know, they should do the self-service. So they need the assistance, right? And the second data point is that today 90% of the population, and I mean it, 90% of the population earn their livelihood in cash. So their earning is in cash. 70% is the agriculturist. So the farmers earn in cash, self-employed people, those who are earning in the cash. So only 10% of the population who is in the jobs and in the employments and, you know, formal employment or the organized employment, they only earn in the bank account. The rest is everybody is earning in the cash, actually. Now what you need is that, at least to start with, that, you know, let this cash get converted into the electronic. And that's what we do, right? So at the first point, you know, you need to convert that. However, you know, if you want to do it, say, for example, and how we executed, you know, so deeply into the, on the ground, if I have to educate, say, millions of consumers, my consumer, it's impossible. I have a 35 million consumer, and if you say that those 35 million consumers need to be educated, it's impossible for us to do that. What we do is that we educate the retailer first, and we train him. And we say that, you know, this is how the transaction will happen and other thing. So now he's trained, he's understood, he is able to do that, and mind well, this guy is also not very literate. He's 7th pass, 10th pass, and we have seen the people who are hardly able to write even the mail also. But they still do the transactions. The reason is that it's so simplified as far as the operation is concerned. However, so we train them how to transact, what are the ways to transact, what this nuances of this particular product, remittance karna hai to kaise karna hai, all those things, right? So once he's being trained, he's understood, then he's be able to provide the services to start with to the consumer. Now what we have done is that, you know, the going forward, you need to migrate these guys also. So we have also developed the app for the consumer, these consumers. A very small consumers, we understand that 30% of our consumers are having the smartphone, Android phone, which we understood, right? So we got the data and we understood. So we created an app, which is the in Hindi and vernacular app, right? So what he does that, you know, when he wants to remit the money, he's already been registered with us. He's already registered his beneficiaries also with us, with the account number and everything. So when he opens the app, he doesn't have to do anything. Of course, the MPIN login happened. And thereafter, he can see directly the beneficiary already been registered by assisted mode. So the same data is available across the platform. And now at the one click, he just put the amount, say 5,000 rupees. And the 5,000 rupees is get deducted from his account. OTP generates, which technologically we also work around, and not work around in the sense that it picks up the from the inbox and appropriately use it, and then the transaction goes through at a one click. So you put 5,000 rupees and submit, that's it. So you know, you need to, people will get migrated over a period of time. You can't expect on the day one, today sitting right now, that, you know, dramatically we are expecting the change. At least you can say that below 50% of the population. Above 50% of the population will be very fast to adopt, you know, everything will happen very quickly. But then I think that's a segment which we are talking about. The inclusion we are talking about for this segment, and not we are talking about the elite class, I would say.
Okay, so now let's talk about the illiterate class. So imagine, to me, an inclusion, a great included India would be, if my panwala accept payments from me on the digital payment from me to him on his mobile. I know that current technologies allow that. And I know that it is not as yet happening. And I think we all agree that that would be the great revolution that we are all looking for. So, Bhavin, anything that you can throw light on this? How do you think can this really happen? I mean, can the Panwala actually accept this? And yeah, these are, and a situation like this, exactly, would be very small payments, very high frequency, very high prone to failure.
So yeah, I mean, since I come from a, you know, a very much a technology background, everything is doable. I mean, so this, what you just spoke about is absolutely doable. You know, but it has many other angles to it in terms of, you know, the Panwala having the patience to raise the bill over his phone and the customer who wants to pay 10 rupees, whether pulling out a 10 rupee note from the wallet and handing it over is easier as compared to, you know, going to his SMS, clicking on a link and making the payment. So I think, I mean, from enablement of such payments, yes, it is happening to a great extent. So let me, you know, quickly touch upon some of the solutions. So EBS is also part of a larger group called Ingenico, which, you know, manufactures POS terminals and MPOS terminals. So from a product and a solution perspective, we have the complete range of solutions. From, for example, if it's a large merchant, large outlet where, you know, busting the queue would be the thing which would be required, we have contactless terminals which will enable that kind of payment. Come to one level down, a large retailer where queue is not a big challenge, you have a normal payment terminal kind of coming in. Then if it's a small retailer where installing EDC device is not going to be economically viable, then we move to a MPOS kind of device which, you know, pairs up with the smartphone of the retailer and kind of the payment happens over there. And even, you know, going one step beyond that is where even deploying an MPOS is not going to be helpful. So let me give the same example of Panwala in a little different way. So let's say this Panwala is now accepting or, you know, doing home delivery. In this case, suppose I am sitting in my office and I ask him to deliver 10 pounds to my house. He says, sir, who will pay me? So I say, okay, you just send me the link and I'll make the payment online. So I think in some context, this will work. So what I'm trying to say over here is, even without an EDC machine or an MPOS, payments can happen in stores. We have all the necessary solutions for that. Again, you know, the limitation we have is we are not a distribution company. We are a technology company. So in terms of solutions, we have it all. Some of them are already in the market, getting deployed in a very big way. The others, of course, you know, will get picked up with partners such as the ones on the panel over here.
I need to answer this. I'm sorry. This is really interesting because I'm glad you went to raise this. And I also want to react to his statements as well, a couple of them. Which is that the first thing is that what you're talking about is a ecosystem, you know, disruption in a major way. We are still talking about what got started in 1989 by Citibank of saying, how do you acquire a merchant? And today is 2016. There has been zero disruption in that, right? So, I'll come back to that as well. So the issue is there are two issues here to get your Panwala to acquire, you know, to get acquired. The first is that India has got about 14.5 million small retailers in the country. If you look at the POS machines today, it's about 1 million odd machines. And they are not unique as well, and they duplicate. They are spread in about 15 odd cities in the country today. Why is that? The issue is today that the merchant acquiring process takes you about 3 to 6 weeks. And it costs you about 25 to 30,000 rupees. This has to change. Is there a way by which using the tools that you have in today, assuming that you have a bank account, you've got Aadhaar and you've got a mobile, can you use this to transform this acquisition process completely? What does it take to self-acquire a merchant? If you do that, if you have that answer, within a week, 15 million retailers will be onboarded as merchants, which is the first part of the story. The second part of the story is we have today gone and utilized the existing sort of our networks to acquire our own merchants. Everybody has their own merchants, especially the PPI space, right? Since it is semi-closed, everybody has to acquire his own merchants. The answer is interoperability. You introduce interoperability of PPIs and you will be able to acquire the merchant just once. But anybody who's got a PPI license or who is a customer can be able to spend at the merchant. You do these things and this will transform the acquisition space completely.
So I know that my panel has suddenly gotten very energized. It's very nice. I hope it gets transferred. But before that, sorry for the your views on this.
Okay, now I want to work on 2 points. First point and this gentleman's point. See, we around 5 years back, we are a money transfer company. Globally, we transfer money and we do transfer money to India, mostly to labor class. All these rural villages, who laborers who work abroad, they transfer money through our system. 5 years back, around 80% of these customers receive physical cash from our outlets or our agents' outlet. We have around 50,000 agents working for us. They all pay cash for these laborers. So when NPCI came, integrated all the banks, we thought, why? How can we do a change to make this, why customers should go to an agent, why physical form writing, why all this ID proof? They spend 100, 200 rupees in taxi or auto rickshaw to come to agent or branch, collect the money and go back. Why can't we change? We piloted it, gone through a lot of struggle to educate and make this conversion. Today, 90% from 80% cash to 90%, it goes online to bank account. So what I'm trying to tell you is, if we can give comfort, convenience, solid product to customer, whether he's illiterate, he'll understand, because it is his money. Very simple, I'm telling you. It will work, because we have seen it ourselves. Today, anywhere in the world, whether it's in US or Australia, 24 hours, a customer sends money, his mother or father or relative hits the bank account instant in 1 second, and he gets an SMS with the balance. You know, that's the way technology has changed in India. Super fine technology we have. Now, about the two, three things he pointed out. Why financial inclusion is not happening is, one is, as he was telling about the technology, range problem, mobile reach, that's one area. But that's not the actual problem. It is the business problem which is actually not growing. Now, we have a POS system, which is swiping cards. This has to move to wallet. Then this merchant acquisition, everybody becomes a merchant. Instantly, I and you become a merchant. For me, you are a merchant, for you, me are a merchant. It just changes. So when everybody is a merchant, everybody pays through merchant online. So that's a business decision. Then, Aadhaar. No,
it's a P2P.
It's so simple. So that means it's a huge disruption going to come in the existing system. Then about Aadhaar. Now Aadhaar has to, I don't know why Supreme Court came with this rule of disallowing, but personally I feel everybody's bank account or prepaid account, or this, at least when it comes to loan, should be with Aadhaar, because then only we can know a credit rating of that individual. Okay, opening account can be without Aadhaar, but at least for giving finance, giving loans, Aadhaar should be made mandatory, so it becomes so easy for all others to see what is the credit history of this customer and then go along. These two, three things can be done, and interconnectivity of all the PPIs. That will make miracle in financial inclusion without doing anything. If RBI makes its change that PPI to PPI, wallet to wallet, you can transfer money, and if some limit can be withdrawn from ATM, there's few three correction in the regulation side, it will just happen.
Yeah. Well, so this is exactly what we are doing, and so the fundamental question here in terms of acquiring a merchant is to be questioned, in the sense that you expect the merchant to pay a merchant service fee, right? When you acquire, so Bhavin is not going to like me for this. You know, fundamentally, why should a merchant pay? Why can't a customer pay? And the way you look at it is that the reason why you have a merchant acquisition and you have the risk, you have all of these things, is because the merchant is being considered as an entity which is going to receive payments and then he's going to pay some services. So somebody is going to take the risk on behalf of the merchant and do the settlement. Now, if he is able to put his own money and if he is able to transact, then the whole system changes. And now you're talking about customer convenience, and customer is willing to pay additional 5 rupees or 10 rupees as a customer convenience fee. And you know, our results actually show that people who have you know, who are merchants, who are typically, you know, less than 35 years, who have most of these, 95% of these guys actually have a smartphone, they are willing to do this. And we have also seen people, see these merchants, and in the last 3 months this has been happening, they're actually doing the load from their credit card, from their net banking accounts on their own. And they're calling our guys saying that I want additional load, so you please pass it on and I will transfer the money. And the moment you do that, they are using it for all the various services that are available in the you know, PPI ecosystem, including transferring money to the customer, which is what we call as you know, the change project. It means that if you go to a Panwala, it's a classic example that Laveesh talked about. You buy pawn for 33 rupees and you give him a 50 rupee note, right? The way we addressed it is that instead of that 17 rupees, can I just pass on that 17 rupees onto your mobile phone, right? And the way you looked at it, the merchant has now become my customer and he is acquiring a new customer for me irrespective of whether he's got a wallet or not. And believe me, this is actually working out well because the customers are simply giving their mobile number, receiving 17 rupees, and he is now going to be having the flexibility to register himself at any point in time whenever he wants. And at the same time, he can just flash his mobile number, keep accumulating the change, and you know, use it for anything and everything instead of getting a toffee or a scale or something which he doesn't like. And that's essentially what we've been doing, and it is showing very positive results. And I just wanted to share with the team here. Thanks.
So here, Laveesh, just one more point here. I think what I wanted to, half a minute, yeah, it won't even. So the reason why I call this is disruption initially was that it needs a disruption is because if you realize in 89 we went and started with a credit card. We were just giving out a spend on credit that these guys did it. So we said if this guy is going to take a risk on credit, who pays for it? And it happens to be, now it's not about credit anymore. It's his own money. It's about debit, right? And we have to change that four model structure which is lying in the system to be able to sort of disrupt this. And
okay, so the gentleman at the back, second and third, one from
here. Yes. Hi, my name is Tarun Mohan, and old telecom background. We're talking about connectivity all across the country not being there, but we had SMS and USSD banking for years. Why hasn't that taken off? Simple to use, every device has it, every telco gives it out. What's the problem there?
No, I'll tell you, it's about pricing. It's about a business model thing. The telcos initially went in and priced it so expensively that nobody ever wanted to use it. And the second thing is that the telcos have no way to do its monitoring of how much of the packets which have gone down in the usage. So you can't do a billing on USSD today. So it's a session based thing. It's based on session. No, it's based on sessions. Yeah. It's not based on transactions.
One session? 150.
Is how many transactions?
Yeah, so we are not having a discussion here. We'll take this off the thing. But USSD is a big hangama. Yeah. And I also suspect that the telcos are to blame. But, well, that's a long discussion, so I'll hold that one.
Thank you.
Yes.
Hi, good afternoon, everybody. Myself is Mohammed Tariq. Basically, I'm from GI Technology. We are the leading for providing, doing domestic money remittance, right? So currently we are doing close to 3 million IMPS transactions, right? So which is top in NCCI. So basically currently everybody is providing the retailer assist model to the customers, right? So customer at least bothered that whether the wallet has been created or not, right? So simply this just come to the retail point, they are giving the money to the retailers and they are giving the accounts, right? And they will straight away they are going. But when it comes to the customers, we are talking about the customer acquiring. So the kind of customers we are talking about, so they are using their mobile phone last 4 years, 5 years, but still they don't even know what is their mobile number. So they know only there are two buttons which is there in their mobile phone, one is green and one is red. Still they don't know what is their mother's maiden name. So how we can solve and how we can address this kind of challenge, who wants talking about the customer acquisitions part?
I'll answer that in two lines. If the product is good, believe you me, the customer gets
we'll learn.
Don't worry about whether he knows his mother's name or not. If it's important to him, he'll know it. So I will not take that question right now. So we'll answer that.
Okay, thank you so much.
Yeah, another one, please. There was a gentleman out here.
Hi, I am Mohit. We have seen mobile money services being becoming popular in a lot of countries in Africa, Latin America, and all. So, and I can give you examples. 99% of school fee payments in Ivory Coast happen through mobile money. That's Orange and MTN and other operators there. We have Safaricom. We have a lot of examples which we have Zimbabwe and all. So, what is the learning which we are taking from international markets, and can we deploy any learning which you guys know into Indian market? And when we were talking about things like doing a 10 rupee payment to a panwala, in Tanzania there's a system where there's a small 600 rupees POS and there's a card linked to your Airtel Money account and you can pay. And they're targeting those small merchants, and it's a sticker, NFC sticker on the back. So even the experience part also comes in, where you do not have to do anything. You have to just tap, and it directly the debit happens from your Airtel Money account. So those kind of things.
Yeah.
So are we taking any learning from the international market?
So I'd like this to be the last closing question. I want us to wrap up our.
Yeah. First of all, I think there's a whole lot of experiences which you can learn from international markets, specifically not about the products but about the models. So there are a lot of countries in the world today who have moved on to adjacency revenues in terms of models, which means that you don't go as per what you've seen at MTN Kenya or M-Pesa saying a charge for every damn transaction. So it's moving away from there. The other thing is that the other countries have had no infrastructure. Zero infrastructure in all those African sort of countries, which has been unfortunate. But India is not in that situation. India has options available which it can use and translate and do things into. And you'll be pleasantly sort of surprised to know the kind of calls which we get almost every week from such countries to know what is India doing. Yeah. So I think it's the other way around now. India is a shining star. India has got a research position where we are advising a lot of countries in the world of what can be done. Yeah.
Very quickly. So I haven't done a lot of work in this space for quite some time, but maybe 5 years back I was very actively studying all these models of M-Pesa and trying to, part of a bank, I was trying to replicate that along with a telecom operator in India. So, see, one of the big differences I see between those markets and India is India has a very strong financial ecosystem. I mean, in terms of the regulations and the kind of, the stability that we have around our banking systems, which was absolutely missing in those countries at that time, at least. Again, as I said, I have not followed it for a long time now. So maybe they were, in a way, lucky to not have a very strong banking regulation. And all these things were allowed to happen, and now it's become, the financial system of that country. We already had many things, and there were, too many safeguards in place. RBI was also opening up regulations one by one. And so, that's where India was not allowed to have that kind of a model. So I think there are pros and cons. While we do not have that kind of thing, we have a very, very stable financial system in the country, and we should be very thankful about that.
I have a two point. One is that I think Pawan and Bhavin has already touched upon. I would say that, there are two things which can drive. One is that ease of transaction and the commercial model. These are the two things need to be set right. If these two things are set right, I think that can be adopted. I have one more point as a part of the conclusion right now.
See, as far as the India inclusion is concerned, we have done great job, and I mean it, a great job, including the PMJDY, is done on the issuance side. So the opening the bank account, the people are now banked, and likewise. The major challenge and the, you know, the issue is right now onto the acquiring side or the transaction. How do we accept the transactions? And there where I think we are deeply missing at this moment. And my worry is that you know, unless and otherwise, and we, of course, I'm part of the various committee and, you know, the government bodies and other thing where we are advising them. Unless and otherwise, the very fast some of the actions are not taken on to the acquiring and the merchant side of it, I think the banking, what we have done, already being carded or already being done, the bank accounts, will get, you know, it will get spoiled, actually. The reason is that if they are not able to do anything on this bank account and card, that will get impacted because they feel it is a useless thing, right? So one more useless things which they have got it now and they will just junk it, actually. So I think dramatically there is an activity which we need to do that, and I hope in this budget there will be a lot of initiative or a lot of some kind of a clear-cut guideline will be given by the finance ministry on the acquiring side. And I think I'm very hopeful on that. So that's fine.
Yeah. Just to add to all the views here, there is one more thing that we as India need to worry about, which is the cultural and demographic, you know, parts that are there, which is very, very unique to our country in terms of delivering these services. And so you have technology.